Hey everybody, Rob here. It's time for a new ProRevenge story. Got my branch manager fired and got four guys promotions. Let's jump right in. Hey, did you know 62% of people who watch my videos aren't even subscribed to the channel? You don't want to be one of those people. Hit that subscribe button for more daily Reddit stories. I worked as a security guard for a standard security company, but we were contracted with a petrochemical company to do security at their world headquarters. The company is a Fortune 500 company, making billions a year. Therefore, the account we had meant that we did security for all of their locations inside the US, while other companies handled sites outside the US. This account was worth around $30 million US a year. I joined the company in March, and things seemed great. My shift was very workable, 10:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m., Monday to Friday. I spent most of my day doing paperwork and signing in other contractors and delivery drivers. Honestly, it felt like a pretty decent job. It didn't pay very well, but you can't complain when you sit on your ass all day. However, soon we began to have a staffing problem. People were leaving and getting fired way too quickly. We were supposed to have about 15 guards, but we got as low as 9. This does not include the 3 veteran guards employed by the client company, as they were separate from us. This is very important later. This caused horrible schedules. In a 26-hour period, I worked 20 hours, which I later found out is illegal in our state, and we would easily put in 60-hour weeks. Every single guard was working overtime. It caused havoc with our personal lives. My girlfriend even told me she was thinking about leaving me because out of the entire week, I would see her maybe an hour a day before I fell asleep, and we lived together. So obviously, some compensation was required. Overtime was decent pay, yes, but we wanted an overall raise. We got paid way too little to be working 70-hour weeks, 12 to 16-hour shifts, etc. Each facility has a supervisor through the contractor company, and each set of facilities has a branch manager who supervises specific accounts for the regional manager. While the branch manager was supposed to visit each facility once a month, there are 3 facilities in his area on the account. I saw him twice in my 1-year period with the company. Apparently, the client company had a lot of pull in the state, so the security company was basically their lapdog, and they tried to keep their distance as much as legally allowed. The issue started when one of the guards, we'll call him Roy, started talking about how his friend, who worked at the sister site, and all of his fellow guards all got raises because they were short-staffed, and the company wanted to thank them for pulling extra hours. This got a lot of the guards furious. We were much worse off with our staff, and we worked at the world headquarters, and none of us had even been suggested raises. This led to the guards being particularly unmotivated and led to people refusing to pick up shifts. So one of the senior guards decided to call the branch manager and complain, asking why the sister site would get raises and why we would not. Apparently, it was more of a rant than an actual conversation, but at the end of it, the branch manager promised he would look at getting our raises, and that he would speak with the regional manager to get the raises going. When word of this reached the facility, it was one of the only things everyone could talk about. We would talk about how excited everyone was to get raises, and the branch manager had also promised that we would be getting new guards to help out, so no more 60 plus hour work weeks. Everything was happy in our world for about 48 hours. When I get to work early morning on Thursday, I see an email address to all the security guards, and our branch manager is CC'd in it. He never gets copied in emails. The email said this: "Hello, as you all are aware of, all of the rumors that have been brought to my attention have been addressed. I would like to take this time and remind everyone not to engage in this activity again. Moving forward, bring all concerns to the attention of your immediate supervisor so they may be addressed. Spreading rumors and causing panic will be looked at as creating an uncomfortable and hostile work environment. Disciplinary action will be taken. Please let me know if you have any questions or concerns about the matter. Also, make sure that your attention while on site is on our purpose. We should all be focused on the objective of providing the client with outstanding service. We were pissed. Basically, we were being told that we weren't getting raises, and the branch manager claimed that the sister site getting raises was nothing but a rumor. Roy was berated for supposedly causing a panic, and since Senior Guard was the one that went over the supervisor and straight to the branch manager, he was being told his job was potentially on the line. Everyone was absolutely appalled, and one of the older guards quit on the spot. The company had basically flat out lied and made promises they had no intention of keeping, and we legally couldn't prove anything. And thus, the revenge starts. We had the phone numbers to the sister site in the directory, but didn't know who the supervisor was over there. I asked Roy who his friend that had worked there was, and if I could get into contact with him. Unfortunately, he had quit and joined the Air Force just days prior. At this point, I felt stuck, but I didn't want anyone to be screwed over by a company just because we were the little people. So I stuck my neck out, and using the phone in my office, I called the client of the sister site. The operator picks up, and I explain that I'm a guard at the headquarters and needed to speak with the supervisor of their site. The operator gladly puts me through. Frank answers the phone, and I explain who I am and why I am calling. I don't BS with him and just flat out ask the big question. Did their site get raises? They did, and then some. Turns out, not only did all their guards get raises, including himself, but they also received bonus checks for their hard work. I could barely speak. I couldn't tell if I was furious at how we had been treated or how thankful I was that Roy and Senior Guard weren't lying. I asked Frank very calmly, "Can I get that in writing?" The next morning, I asked for a meeting with the branch manager, the site supervisor, the client, and the three guards that were willing to show up. Myself, Roy, Senior Guard, and a random guard who was willing to be present. He was in the loop most of the time. The branch manager is annoyed by this meeting and demands to know what is going on. Senior Guard and I explain how we are here to address how employees were lied to and how we were being threatened because we wanted compensated just as much as the sister site. And on top of that, how all four of us would leave if this issue was not addressed. What are they talking about? We have made it clear that the rumors have been addressed and that no such promises were made. This meeting is over. Not so fast, sir. There is one other person that would like to speak with you. And in walks the knight in shining armor, Frank. We watch in amusement as all the color drains from branch manager's face. He stands there completely still, not making a sound. Frank smiles in an almost predatory fashion as he knows the slaughter he is about to partake in. Who is this? I am the site supervisor for your other site. I have here documentation that not only did branch manager lie about my guards getting raises, but also a recorded phone call, being all calls from company phones are monitored, that has branch manager on record stating that he was going to pursue seeking a raise for this site's guards. At this point, even I am speechless. I didn't know how he got a copy of the phone call between Senior Guard and branch manager, but he did and was holding the transcript. The client goes from confused to angry, glaring at the branch manager. The branch manager is still standing there, white as a ghost, and now our site supervisor is staring at him in what looks like pure rage, mostly because he took the flack for the branch manager's lies. How did you... You're right, branch manager, this meeting is over. For you, get out of my office. The branch manager glances at myself and Senior Guard in what looks like pure defeat and mopes out of the office. Frank, let me see what you have. Frank hands over all the evidence and the client looks through it for about 5 minutes. He finishes going over it and closes the booklet and looks over at the site supervisor. Did you know about this? The site supervisor explains how he was simply doing what he was told and not to ask questions. He was ex-military, so that mindset was believable. After this, the client instructed all of us to go home and we would be given money for the shifts we were supposed to work, but instructed us to come back at 7 a.m. sharp the next morning and to meet in the conference room. We all show up the next day and we are greeted by the client and another younger lady who explains to us is the financial manager of the whole company. The branch manager is also sitting there, but on the other side of the conference table. We sit down and she starts off by apologizing for the behavior of the branch manager and explained how they did not like this sort of thing. However, since he was a contractor, they could not legally hold him accountable. The branch manager seemed somewhat relieved by this, and my heart admittedly sank. She said we could file reports against him and they would confirm them, but they could not partake in any form beyond that. Then, the financial manager gives the big but. She says her offer is that we can work for the client, personally, as an in-house security and not contractors. They said they would hire all four of us on the spot and we could start working tomorrow. This included full benefits, a huge increase in pay, over $20 an hour, and 6 weeks of vacation time a year. However, the offer only stood while we were in the room. The branch manager is fuming as he has just lost four guards. Of course, we all accept. She makes it clear, however, that we aren't hired until the meeting is over. Then, the financial manager's attention turns to the branch manager. She explains that since four guards had just quit, that he was now in severe violation of the contract due to lack of staff and that they were using the break clause to terminate the account effective immediately. The branch manager tried to argue, saying that stealing contractors with the intent of using a break clause in a contract is illegal, which it is. Her response is something like this: "You are correct, which is why these men are not currently employed by us. They left on their own accord and are unemployed. Since this is a severe violation of the contract, we will be dealing with this here and now." The branch manager is speechless at the perfectly deceptive and well-played loophole that the client company had just exploited, and was also told if they did decide to pursue a lawsuit, they would be allowed to legally bring the evidence of the contractor company's deception and blatant lies to its employees. The client and the financial manager spend the next 4 hours taking phone calls, and we can't leave the room. After they hang up the phone for the last time, the client turns to the branch manager and explains calmly but firm, "Please step outside with me for a moment." He also gestures for myself and senior guard to stand up and follow them. We walk outside and the client smiles. "OP, senior guard, would you please, as my security officers, escort branch manager off-site? His company is no longer associated with us." We gladly escort him to his car. 3 years after this happened and all four of us still work there, we heard from another guard that the branch manager was fired basically as soon as he got back to his company's headquarters, and Frank was offered the branch manager position. He apparently responded by handing them his resignation letter. He went to move on to another security company overseas, as last I knew, he had been in France for almost a year. Site supervisor was moved to another facility, but still works for the company last I checked. We love working for the client, and all four of us became good friends. We all work similar shifts, so every Friday after work, we all go to the bar and have a good time. We also became fairly close to the client, so he invites us over to his house for special occasions. And yes, the security director for a petrochemical company has it big. Thanks to my job, however, I was able to save my relationship, take great vacations, buy a brand new, at the time, Chevy Silverado, and buy an actual house. So, to sum things up, don't f*** with the security guard. I was reading the comments on this story, and one of them really stood out because of how true it is. It says, "A lot of these stories are really well put together, and you guys know how to set up a catastrophe really well. Since that's so, could everybody please stop saying, 'This is important for later'? I'm reading along, it's well written, it's clear, and you stop the forward motion by saying, 'Hey, dummy, don't forget this.' Have you ever seen that in any professional writing? The answer is no. Stop it, and remember that. It's important for later. See, doesn't that look dumb?" I want to thank OP for posting their story to the ProRevenge subreddit. You can visit them at the links in the description below. Please go there and give them an upvote. Once again, this is Rob from Karma Comment Chameleon saying thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please hit that subscribe button, drop a like, and share it with your friends, and we'll see you in the next one.